And so let me talk to you a little bit tonight about wafer seals on U.S. folded letters and envelopes. And the period I'm going to cover this evening is 1840 to the 1860s. And what you can see here on the first slide is some of what we're going to be discussing. And in some cases, they're transparent. In other cases, they're not. And right in the middle is a really rare, there's not many of these that have survived, envelope with which you would purchase. And inside of this envelope, you would have some of these mini sheetlets here on the left and right, which are transparent motto wafers. And we'll go into some more detail as to the types and the sayings and how they were used. And you'll see at the bottom of the screen, a number of others that are not transparent, but they're just printed on thicker pieces of paper and they're gummed. And again, just really unique little piece and a little area of study that goes way back, and it started really in Great Britain, and then it was brought over here to the US. So let me advance my slide. And let's talk a little bit about the introduction of wax and sealers. And I think we're all aware of utilizing wax to seal letters. But if you're not here, when writing letters was primarily reserved for royalty, the custom was to seal letters with wax using a handheld wooden and brass sealer. And so here in the center is just an example of one of those wooden and brass sealers that I have in my collection. I probably have 15 or 20 of these from the late 1790s to the mid 1860s. But they all look very similar and they all have various brass heads on them, which most of them can be unscrewed and you can replace these with various types of seals. And so here on the left is an older seal, that's got an image of a horse on it and some words around the periphery. Here on the right is another type of seal that was used to seal a folded letter or any sort of letter or envelope. And so this one again has sort of the town on it and some initials below the city and or state. Sometimes you'll have the name of the family. You'll have various initials of the individual. So they're very diverse, but that was the methodology by which a letter, which, you know, you did not want anybody to seal the contents and you were transporting it from A to B, you would seal it so that you could ensure it was secure and that it would get there and not be opened. And in England after 1635, the post office was no longer only serving really the royalty. And so the upper class took that up, you know, upper classes took up that sealing methodology. And so this then became very pervasive and very rampant across, like I said, mostly where I'm starting is in Great Britain and the United Kingdom. I've listed some references here at the bottom if anybody's interested. Author Groton, Dr. Arthur Groton, really is one of the preeminent researchers and studiers and presenters of early wafer seals. And he's done such a phenomenal job. There's a few references there in the American Stamp Dealer and Collector from 2009, 2012. And he's got a very diverse and broad topic. He's studied a lot about the UK and other countries in Europe that use these. My focus has been, at least where I started collecting, on those that were used here in the US. And so the wafer seal is developed. So eventually moving from wax, they moved to these transparent and non-transparent wafer seals. And they were developed as an alternative solution for sealing letters. Folded letters. And remember, this is before the envelope was even invented. And so you really had one large sheet of paper. You wrote your letter on it using as many sheets as possible within that. You folded it up, as we call it, a folded letter sheet, and then you sealed it on the back. And if you weren't using wax, you could then use these very small. These are not large wafers. They are about 15 by 12 millimeters. And so if you have a definitive stamp in front of you and you know the size of any traditional definitive US or even a commemorative, this is a little bit smaller than that, quite a bit. They're symmetrically shaped. They're colored paper. They're gummed on the reverse. The two in the center here that I'm showing are transparent. So they're on this a very transparent type of almost cellophane. And you have printing, usually gold, on the surface. And the one in the middle there, you know, this is just one example, has a musical staff and words above and below. If you look closely, do you ever think of me? So you have to think about when we look at who was sending these, you know, young ladies sending them to young beaux and young beaux sending them to young ladies and other types of correspondence, a son to her mother and vice versa. They would use these on the back. You also had various businesses and political and a number of other things at the time that were being sent back and forth, and they would use specific labels as well. Some were also to specific events in time. And so you'll see a very broad array of sayings. One here in the middle that's blue, procrastination is the thief of time. You're going to see very, very similar phrases and mottos, initials, scenery, images. The two on the one on the left and the one on the right, those are on a thicker bond type paper. They're not transparent wafer likes, and they are printed in multiple colors on them. This one says forever with two hearts, flowers, and an arrow. The one on the right is friendship, love, and truth with interconnected rings and a floral pattern. And so this is a very small example of what these wafers were like. And so initially, again, popular in Britain, they depicted a wide array of these scenes. And eventually by the late 1830s, really 1838, 1837, 38, they made their way into the United States. And so I'm going to walk you through a little bit about the wafers, what they look like, some of the sayings and phrases, and then I'll go through some highlights from my collection of a number of different various examples used pretty broadly, most used in New England, some used in the South, very few during this time period were used out on the West Coast or even in middle. And so most in big cities and small cities, wherever folks are starting to do a little bit more writing, especially during this time period, you'll find these transparent and just these motto wafers. And then they grew. They're not always available on the back of some of the covers when you're looking, but the ones that still have them, and if you can get the contents of those various letters, it's even more intriguing to see what they were writing about. And we'll go through some of that. So first, let's start off with the transparent motto wafer. And this is a very few of these envelopes have survived. I'm fortunate to be able to have this envelope. It measures 145 by 78 millimeters or so. It's about the size of a standard envelope. It is beautifully printed on the surface if you look closely, with doves in the center, at least birds in the center, a beautiful scrollwork and floral pattern. The paper, if you see it, is very glossy on the surface. You'll see the flap, which I've opened up as well. So you can see what the back flap looks like. And this is what housed these gummed sheets. This housed the transparent motto wafers when this came across my desk many years ago and I was able to acquire it. It is from about 1840, the best that we can put a date on it. Here is the back of the envelope showing it open with the flip up. Again, it's a blue design. It's on this glossy outer paper. And it's on this thicker bond. It's not as thin as a traditional envelope. The manufacturer and I have looked long and hard at all of the various scrollwork here to see if there's some sort of micro printing of who might have manufactured this and or a date, as other envelope manufacturers did later on. But in this case, there is none that can be found. What you will notice is that it is not gummed on the flap. So this is even before they would gum this envelope. It simply was, you know, very loosely held together, and these individual little sheetlets were placed inside of it. And this is how you bought these at various sundries back then during that era, or, you know, supply shops, good stores, all of that. So when I did receive this envelope and I looked inside of it, I was amazingly pleased to find that the contents were still in there. And so here is an example of an intact mini pane, if you will, 5x7 that was contained within that envelope. This is a sheet of gummed wafer seals that came in that envelope that I showed you. It is gold printing on a transparent or translucent blue. It's almost like lucite, and it's like a plastic. And you can see that many have been clipped off and were used. So, and I just highlighted a few And you know, once this is posted online and you can blow up the PowerPoint yourself, you can see some of the other sayings that were on here, absent but not forgotten. We talked about it earlier, procrastination is a thief of time. Take me in, my happy home, accept 10,000 thanks. So many, many different little quips and phrases here, depending on who you were writing to and how you were feeling. You would clip out the one that you thought was most appropriate. You would put it on the back of your envelope when you were ready to seal it, and you would seal it and send it on its way, or your folded letter. And I'm going to show you real examples of them, real world, when we get to some of them. I think I'll show you 20 or so from my collection. I think I have now about 150 covering this period of time from the stampless to the just into the Civil War period. And I'll show you chronologically some of their use when I get to the covers. So this is a little sheet on blue. Also in that same envelope when I acquired that envelope was these gummed wafer seals in red. And again, you can see that the individual that owned this prior, at least way back in the 1840s, had also cut a few out specifically and used them. Again, this is gold, silver. I think it's really more of a silver than a gold, and I should change that. On red, transparent, the back is gummed. And you can see again some of the sayings. We cannot recall the past. All's well that ends well. I bear the hopes of many. Forget and forgive. I think we say forgive and forget, but in this case, it's forget and forgive. And finally, fear not, but trust in providence. You can see a number of different designs. Some are just words. There's a lot of musical notes and staffs on this. And I guess I should sit at my piano in the music room and try to hit a few keys and see if I could decode some of the beginning of these verses that they're trying to share. But you could see musical notes here, Here's a staff, another staff, three or four, five, there's at least seven or eight on this particular sheet. This measures 65 by 52 millimeters. So again, not that large, a couple of inches by a few inches. Again, each wafer measures about 13 by 10 millimeters. So again, very tiny. Oh, here up at the top, you can see at the upper right, my happy home again with da, 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 and you can see the musical staff there. Apologies for my bad music. These I was very excited to find as well. Completely different type of sheet, near complete. This is what the size of the sheet would look like. This was not in that envelope, by the way. These are not transparent motto wafers, but just what we would call wafers. Regular old, you know, notion labels, sometimes they're called. And these are multicolored scenes, very diverse on gummed paper. And you can see the gum on the back. I'm showing the front and the back. Again, it's just beautiful to find this intact from 1858, where again, only a few of these seals were removed and used by whomever the original purchaser was back in the 1850s. And these are very colorful, a little bit more easier to read. And when I highlight them and blow them up on the next few slides, you know, you can probably find one or two of your favorites buried within. But if you were writing to somebody that you cared about or you loved, parent or, you know, girlfriend, boyfriend, etc., you would definitely pick the right one, maybe even a friend or so or a relative. And so here's the top half of that sheet. You know, I highlighted a few: hope, affection, forever, from a friend. You can see, you know, here hope, a sitting figure with the anchor and all. Here a friend and the Bible is pictured right in the center. You even have some, you know, more, because this is from the late 1850s, sort of political here: justice, hail Columbia, liberty. So you've got a little, even be industrious. And here's a beehive, busy as a bee. You know, affection with two doves, you know, sweet home showing a little college, a cottage. So these are just really, really pretty. These are multicolor, clearly printed in multiple passes here. Again, early 1858. You see, they all have a little frame around them as well, sort of to help you cut them out. But how I know this is a complete pane is that there's a complete frame around the entire outside of this if I go back. So this really was the size of the sheet. This is about 110 millimeters by 80 millimeters. So that's the top half. here's the bottom half. And so again, I think, you know, upper right corner, strike while the iron is hot. Here's a blacksmith striking the iron. God bless you in the center. Here is goodbye, a ship, a tall masted ship sailing. Remembrance, forget me not with the flowers. You even have farewell here and a rider bringing news. So you could, you know, just send the news of what was happening of the day, and you were sending a note, and you would add this little label to the back. Stop your clatter with a parrot. I mean, so this is some great little sayings in here. And so, again, you'll see when we start to get to some uses, you know, of how they were added and where they were added. So let me move on to some examples, and I'll walk you through. And here is probably one of my earliest, really, from the U.S. We said it was late 1830s that they came here. This I have narrowed down to about 1840, based upon the addressee and where they were living, and then who wrote the letter. This is a real early envelope, too. There is no gum on the flap if I turn it over. It is an ungummed, unsealed envelope. I've exploded it. It was barely held. It was not held together. You actually bought the stationery, and who made the stationery, because that is on the piece of paper at the lower right, was Addenbrooke, a very famous British stationer. And you would get these envelopes as they were, and you would write your letter. You would put them inside, and you would then fold the flaps yourself, and you would use one of these labels, as you see here, to seal. So if you look at the upper left, you see that the label is still attached to the back flap. It was neatly cut out by the recipient, but you can see how it was glued down and held this closed. And those are the contents. It's a 3-page letter. It's beautiful little lace piece of paper. And this was definitely sent outside the mails from Brooklyn, New York. It went to a Miss Miriam Allen in Rahway. There is no state there, but we know it's New Jersey. And if you read the contents of the letter, you can tie that letter back to New Jersey and to New York City. And it's a 2-page letter from her friend, Amelia Everill. And they go into some specific details, and they talked about events, clearly, which were very important to Amelia that she wanted Miriam to know about. I think hence why she used the important label. This is a little different. This is in the shape of a diamond. And so you're going to see not every one was rectangular like I showed you earlier. This one is more diamond shaped. You'll find others that are diamond in the vertical. There are others that are circular. So a number of different shapes and sizes. You'll also see as I go through this, a few not in other languages. And so we'll go through a few, but just a very nice little way to intro from very early in this period where it was just starting to be used here in the US on this stationery and early envelopes, again, that were not gummed. So if they were not gummed and you were sealing, you had to use the mechanism of either doing wax, and you'll still find plenty of wax seals being used through this period, even up until, I want to say, you started to see them go away by the early 1850s. But the labels persisted. So here's, and the way I'll lay these out is each slide at the upper, at the top, the title is the what is on the label. I'll show the labels blown up, and then I will reduce and show within each slide the folded letter or the envelope, because the star of the presentation really is the little labels, but the covers also tell a great story, and there's a lot of postal history involved with routes and rates, who was sending them, where they were sent to. You've got a broad array of manuscript markings, cancellations, colored cancellations. You have large post office, you have small post office. You have some like this letter, which is a folded letter sheet that have contents. This one has 4 pages of contents, for example. And so that's how I've laid them out. And I try to, at least in the upper right corner, you know, try to at least put a little bit of a character with a little summary related to what we're talking about. And so that's how the next, you know, few slides are going to be as we go through this presentation. So on the back of this folded letter sheet, Clearly, there's no gum. It is not an envelope. You had to seal it. And in some cases, there's a disc on the inside or a piece of wax. And in some cases, they use multiple methods in addition to using this little wafer. And this one says strike while the iron is hot. We saw one earlier on the multicolored labels that had one. Here's a real early one from 1847 that's, you know, a little bit of a different scene, but some of the themes persist. And you could see it's here on the back. I've turned the envelope over the way at least it was sealed just to show this. Interestingly, this individual that wrote the letter was not done and added on the inside of this letter, right below their signature after they wrote the letter, they just had a biblical quote, Philippians chapter 1, verse 3. And this is sealed, like I said, on the inside. So what does that mean? You know, it means I thank my God every time I remember you. So without saying it, the label using this biblical verse, which is why I have an old Bible up here, told the individual that received this and reading this, if they read their scripture, that I thank my God every time I remember you. And so not only were these labels or little mottos used to seal, they also were used to tell a message from the sender to the recipient within the letter. And so I think, again, I've seen this many, many times used, well, not many times used, but enough in looking at hundreds of these that the individuals that were using these motto wafers would also tip them in on the inside and glue them there to also send an additional message. So a really nice letter sheet. This was sent to, you know, from Winfield, New Hampshire, to a Miss Jonathan Ross in St. Johnsbury, Vermont, not that far of a distance, 1847. And you'll see a manuscript town at the upper left, dated May 25th. And at the upper right, you'll see a very faint five, which was the rate at the time to go this distance for first class single sheet, 1847 rates. And so that's the first. So let's continue to look and see how some additional wafers or seals were used. Here's an envelope from about 1849, because we have a crayon, contemporary blue crayon here, docketed 1849 at the left. And this little wafer seal says hope deferred, et cetera, with the ampersand C period of the era with a small anchor below it. And then this is a little sort of embossed envelope. We would call it a lady's envelope, if you will. And again, you had the seal that was used to seal, at least partially seal this. Sometimes if the envelope is gummed, they would seal it by licking the envelope and sealing it. They would still put the wafer seal on to send the message, even though it was not absolutely needed to seal the envelope. And then if we look at the front of this, and this was sent from Wilmington in Connecticut, this is just a pretty little envelope, as you can see, that's taken a little journey. At the upper left, it left Wilmington in Connecticut on May, and you see they didn't have the slug in for the date, so they manuscript wrote in 10. And they had a really nice, very large, hollow Roman numeral V, which was the rate. You just don't see many of this type, but it was 5 cents to get to Reverend Daniel Noyes in South Andover, Mass. So it went to Andover post office, and the Reverend wasn't at home. And so the Andover clerk struck it the next day. It made it to Andover, May 11th, and wrote manuscript up here forwarded because they knew that the Reverend had traveled to Brooklyn. So they knew to forward it to Brooklyn, but that was going to cost an additional 5 cents to forward it. So the Andover clerk was able to write a manuscript 5, underline it, and sum those up and hit a hand stamp, a large number 10, which meant, you know, due upon receipt in Brooklyn at the Reverend to pick up that mail, he would have to pay that 10 cents. And so in my mind, this made it to Brooklyn. It did say, please forward immediately. And the reason I believe that is that for me, that the 1849 in the blue marking here, it was either done when the Reverend picked it up and paid that 10 cents and was done by the clerk, most likely, upon receipt in New York. So just again, you've got a beautiful piece of postal history. You've got some great markings on it as well. You've got, you know, and you've got a nice wafer seal on the back hope deferred. There are no contents in these two. If there are any contents, I would let you know and maybe try to say a word or two about what the conversation was. So here is a diamond in the vertical, and it's a very nice label on a stampless folded letter. And this says, forget me not. And this is a little bit larger than your typical labels that we've been seeing, but it is on the reverse of a folded letter sheet. And this was absolutely used to seal the contents. They could have used a wax seal. They did not. They chose to use this gum label after they folded the letter up. And it has a lot of contents. I think you could see through this and you could see the writing. So it's a very thin blue paper. It's watermarked. It was sent from New York City, 1848. It has a very bold, typical New York City, November 1st, integral 5-cent hand stamp. It's right here. In 1848 again, and you can see that it was sent to a Miss Mary E. Washburn, care of Mr. J. Washburn in Lyme, New Hampshire. And so this made its trip from A to B. It was sealed well, a lot of contents inside this, mostly family matters, from a cousin writing to a cousin from New York City, asking, when are you coming to visit us on the Isle of Manhattan? And here at the upper right is the old New York City post office right downtown where this letter absolutely would have been sent from in 1848. This was in the old Dutch Reformed Church that was converted to a post office in 1850. So again, and it says, forget me not. So when are you coming to visit? So here is another. And this is a diamond, a smaller little diamond shaped label. And it says, what news, ? And this again was not really used to seal, but more of sending a message. There are no contents. The envelope at the time was gum. This is a round. This is used between 1847 and 1851. It is not dated, but how was I able to narrow it down? I'm able to narrow it down. If you look at this, really, this is a very uncommon use. There is no circular date stamp. All that is on this envelope is a very bold, large, with a Roman number 2 in this double circle blue. This is a very well-known drop rate hand stamp from Philadelphia that was used between those periods, 1847-51. And so this had to enter the mail within the city limits of Philadelphia. They had the double circle 2 on it, and it was addressed to a Miss Annie Ash, care of Mr. George W. Ash, at 194 North 6th Street in Philadelphia. So this was local, this was drop. And it only cost you 2 cents at that time. And it didn't cost you the additional 3 cents to make it a 5-cent, right? Because it was inner city. So no doubt it was probably sent from the post office, but you know, here I just show a typical tavern in Philadelphia from that period. And as we know, taverns also played a role in the movement of information, current events, newspapers, mail, et cetera, et cetera. That's who you would gather to find out what was going on. And here they're asking what news. So I wish the contents were here and I could tell you, but we just have to guess who was writing to Miss Annie Ash. So here's another one from not far from where we are here in Pennsylvania, New Berlin, which is actually right up here, up the block. This is also sent to a very famous local Lancastrian, who we can talk a little bit about when I get to it. But this says old friends and true friends here on the label. This is a transparent motto wafer, which was still being used into the 1850s to mid 1850s until some of those other labels were created. Again, you'll see a musical staff surrounded by this gold frame again on a wafer. You know, it's interesting because they use this seal is gummed. There is a little wafer underneath this that was used to seal the envelope, but they still put the wafer seal on it. And this was sent to, if you see the name North, you may know who I'm referring to because you know of the North Museum of Nature and Science here in Lancaster. And you know, I'm the board president of that fantastic organization right there on the F&M campus. And this is Hugh M. North Esquire in Columbia, PA, right down here on the river, who the museum was founded from, this family line. And so a lot of correspondence can still be found from Hugh M. North, very prominent attorney in these parts during this period, and his subsequent sons and family. And so this is, again, was sent in New Berlin. It cost 5 cents to go from New Berlin to Columbia. You could have gotten on a horse yourself and probably brought it there quicker. And we know that Mr. North received it because there is docketing on the back of the envelope. This is typical Hugh North docketing. I've got probably 30 other letters coming in to Hugh, and he signed it this way, or his assistant received July 18th, 1850, Thursday, answered on a Monday. So again, no contents, but again, just another use of the wafer on an envelope that's local to us. And here's a little image that I found of Main Street, New Berlin. This is from a postcard that I have that just shows New Berlin from very early 1900s, 1905, 1906. Here's another little letter. Rural free delivery. Time flies, a diamond shaped. So I showed you my little pane of rectangles. They also made little panes of transparent model wafers in diamonds. I've not seen one intact. I'd love to find a few multiples just to add it to this grouping. Again, a nice envelope with no contents. Again, we put this in the category of a ladies' letter or ladies' envelope, if you will. It's circa 1850. It was sent from Wilmington, Delaware. And it was at the time 5 cents to get from A to B. It was sent to a Miss Rebecca Griffith. I am still trying to decode, and this was sent to Chester County. You know, I've got the books and the internet, and I search to try to decode what little town or hamlet that this was sent to, and I still have yet to identify it. And it just could be that it went to an estate, and that's the name of the estate. Decode, even looking at the other letters there and trying to decode, I think it ends in a Y. And I think there's two I's within there because I can see the two periods. But, you know, in a couple of the references of every city and town in Pennsylvania and in Chester County, I have yet to identify it. But I will, you know, I will try to do my best to identify this. But again, a nice little use of a transparent model wafer. So here for me is a real beautiful cover. And it is a cover. There are no contents, but this is like the trifecta, because you have a beautiful green Thorndike mass, which was known to use these greens through this period, even into the stamped era, and they're well sought after. They also used a green hand stamp on their rate. So you see a green five, a very prominent five. And then the sender used a green transparent model wafer. So lovely to see that they married all of those together. And what does it say? Fondly and with affection be true. And, you know, these wafers, because of the type of material they were on, you could just see, and I didn't mention this earlier, you'll start to see with age cracking. They are fairly brittle. This, again, envelope, while it had gum on it, you can see that this covered and transited the flap onto the lower part. So this was used to seal this envelope that was put in the mail to a Mr. Artemis Haynes. I don't know of any Artemis. That is some name there on that cover. But he was there in Palmer Depot, Mass., not too far. So what's interesting here is, one, they February looks like 14th. So this was a Valentine. No doubt was a Valentine. I wish I had the contents. I think why the label was used fondly and with affection be true. But it was re-rated too, as if it was a local drop. And I just started to do a little work on Palmer Depot, which I believe was like literally up the block from Thorndike. So would not have been anything worth 5 cents, but yet two, because it was within, I believe, quote unquote, let's call it the Thorndike city limit. So really pretty little card, a little envelope with a nice wafer. And again, green on green on green. Just a nice use. Let's go to Nashville. Let's go to downtown Nashville. So this is a really interesting, larger envelope, very atypical envelope. If you can see down here at the lower left, the way that it's almost handmade. You have two flaps folding in from the left and the right, one on either side with the center. So this really almost looks as if they took a sheet of paper, they cut it down to their right size once they put the contents within, and then they folded it and they sealed it with three labels. So here's a real great example of where these had a functional use of sealing this, where you could fold anything any size and you could one send a message and you could functionally seal the contents within it and put it in the mail stream. So you've got three labels. You have love has eyes, again, with the scale. You have on the right, remember, again, with musical notes there. And if somebody wants to play those, and maybe it's like the old name that tune. If somebody can name that tune, I'd love to know. But look what's in the middle. We've got a Scottish phrase, Fra Ye Kenwa, from You Know Who. So this was sent to a Mrs. George Waite, care of Waite and Vernon, Albany, New York. And, you know, clearly, they wanted that person to know it was coming from, and they wanted them to remember that love has eyes. And so it was sent from Nashville. There are no contents on January 28th, Tennessee, a nice early use. This was about 1850, and it was struck with the paid and the 10. So as we saw earlier, those were due the payment upon receipt by the addressee. In this case, with this letter, The sender, when they went to the Nashville Post Office to mail it, actually paid that 10 cents up front, which is why the clerk in Nashville struck the paid on it to show that 10 cents was not due when it reached Albany. And so the fact that it was also going to a Mrs. George's Waite and it was going to the company as well, and I haven't looked up Waite and Vernon, curious to understand or know what the contents was, but I can tell you it definitely was thicker and over the half ounce because it was sent double the rate. So that's why it was struck with the 10, which is why I think it was prepaid. Didn't want Mrs. Waite to have to pay that when it arrived. So a really nice use, again, of multiple labels, diamond and rectangle, multiple languages. You've got Scottish and English on there. You've got musical symbols. And you've got what appears to be a homemade envelope. And this is a bit larger than your traditional envelope that was sent and made it to its endpoint. Another very nice one. And again, little downtown Nashville, Tennessee at the upper right from around 1850. So here's another one that's close to home. Actually, that was sent right from here in Lancaster. And this is from a friend. Again, the diamond gold on a thicker piece of paper. So this is interesting because, again, you can see that there is a large red biscuit, which was also sold during this period of time, even when you had gummed envelopes or ungummed envelopes. The gum wasn't great and didn't always seal. So you would add that additional red wafer, which was gummed on both sides to help seal it. And in this case, this label was put on top and you could see where the top flap, which is tucked inside, was still attached because they cut the top flap open, but left the little wafer attached below. So double the sealing power here. And this went to Baltimore. And so again, a black at the time they were using black ink, you will find that Lancaster used red ink and also used blue ink over the 10, 15 years that we're covering here. In this case, black on July 2nd, they struck it with a large bold 5, very typical, and it went to a Mr. M. M. Jekyll. I think that's how it might be Jekyll, but that's what I've put in there for now, and it went to number 258 Baltimore Street. Here's a nice little image of downtown Lancaster City, and you could see a little train here on the tracks just coming through. It's possible it traveled, this letter, back then in 1850, on a train to go from Lancaster to Philly, or it took the old post road on Lincoln Highway to get out there. So again, a nice little letter with, again, no contents. Here's one from home. And this is really neat because this actually did travel on the railroad to go from A to B. And this is from home. Again, a nice little envelope. Always, again, I remind you, when you're looking through boxes of envelopes or letters in anybody's box or your own, always turn the envelope over because you never know what you'll find. And that's why, again, you know, we're looking at all of these various envelopes of folded letters, and you might have one of these little labels on the back, and you might even have contents within the letter that are worth reading to give you a picture of the day of what was going on in these individual lives back during this period. You also see some of the writing from when this was auctioned off way back when as well. You could see Kelleher. You could see what, 44 and 11. Presume it was lot 44, maybe at the time sold for $11 if you want to decode it that way. But what's beautiful about this really on the front is it's got, now we're moving into 1852. You're starting to now, the sending a letter was what, 3 cents for anywhere in the U.S. other than to California for 3,000 miles around, it cost you three. This is here in the upper left-hand corner, not the traditional upper right, and it is struck with a beautiful blue, large railroad cancel, Concord and Montreal Railroad. Not a very common railroad. There is a picture of the General Peasley, which is ran the Concord and Montreal line, and this ended up going to a Charles H. Robertson in Keene, New Hampshire, which is where this line ran to Montreal as well. So just a really nice 11A on cover, 1852, that was sent from home going to Charles on the rail. So the rail alone. So again, this couple of really neat things with this beautiful cover, and there's your nice label. So here's another one from Newcastle, Delaware. Then You'll Remember Me. I think you'll see there was a lot of musical staff notes here within a lot of these labels when you're talking about the transparent motto wafers. When we get to the later thicker paper ones, they're more, you know, scenes and mottos and images. I have not played these notes yet to know if I can ID that tune, but this too was used to seal the envelope, or at least help seal the envelope. A nice blue Newcastle, Delaware. You've got a, here's a different type of strike. This is, again, about 1853, again, when the rates in July 1st, 1851 became 3 cents for anything under 3,000 miles. This is a paid, an arced paid integral three, showing that this, again, was prepaid and sent. If it was not paid and it was sent unpaid, it would have been five. So here you had at least prepay and not pay the 5 cents. And where was this going? This was going to a 6 mile run in Somerset County, New Jersey, to a Miss Mary Voorhees, and Then You'll Remember Me. Again, I don't, there are no contents in this particular one to speak of. And there again is a picture of downtown Newcastle at the upper little horse and wagon and a number of folks walking the street. Forget Me Not. Here's a different type of wafer, but again, a diamond. It is on thicker paper. It's almost like embossed. This is embossed and it's got raised frame and it was impressed within the center, Forget Me Not. So here's another type. Multiple manufacturers getting in on stationery and labels, making all sorts of different types. And in many of these cases, which I mentioned earlier, I really can't identify who the manufacturer was of these different types. Suffice to say, no doubt there were many stationers that were making these labels and selling them during this period. And it's, again, like I said, very nice when you could find them intact, especially when you find them intact on the cover where they were used. Again, this one attached to the rear flap at the top. This wasn't specifically used to seal it because there is a little bit of a wafer underneath it, and this envelope was gummed. This has a very pretty 3 cent on as well from about 1854. It was sent from Franklin, New York. Here is the post office, circa 1850, 52, right there where this letter would have been dropped into that mail slot and sent on its way. And where did it go? It went from Franklin, New York, all the way out to Ravenswood, Long Island. No doubt by rail as well when it got there to a Miss Mary Heyer. Forget Me Not. So now we'll start to get to, on the last few slides before I sort of give you a little bit more history of the envelope and these labels and how long they lasted and when they started to stop being, you know, in use. Here is one of those thicker paper, layered on top, printed, multicolored. This one says Remembrance. In the center in gold, surrounded by a floral bouquet, mostly roses, but, you know, some bluebells and maybe some other types within there. Again, no contents. has remembrance, and it was sent from Batavia, New York. Again, a 3 cent, about 1858. This is now a number 26, so we're getting later. So we know it's 1858, 59. This was sent in late December, so maybe a holiday card, or maybe wanting to be remembered as a multicolored floral bouquet. Again, I would put this in the category of a lady's envelope. Mr. Sylvester B. Taylor in Bristol, New Hampshire, and the county written as often was to get it to the right place in Grafton County. As you know, in some states, they were the same town names, but in different counties. So in this case, you had to be very clear. Most likely a holiday or a remembrance of a family member. The upper right, I could not find a nice downtown picture of the Batavia Post Office, but I did find a nice engraving of the fish mold house that was in Batavia, which is a big business back then up in that part of New York. So now we're getting to sort of the late mid-1860s, sort of where you start to see the use of these labels go out of favor. And I think this might be the last slide where I show the use of these labels before trying to put a bow on this topic. This one says forever, again, with the arrow, two hearts, floral bouquet on a really nice envelope below. Now we're into, again, the 1860s, early 1860s, and you've got now a 3 cent national banknote on it. Number 65 with a very typical double circle Boston mass in red, sent on January 29th. You've got their typical black segmented court cancel on there. And this was sent to where? A Miss Lila Pease in Clinton, Mass. So again, not far up the block. And there's a nice picture of downtown Dock Square in Boston, 1860, circa where this was sent from. And so anything after this period, too, you're really going to start to see the use of these labels sort of fade away. And there's a reason for that. Just temporally across this time, when in the early days you had wax, you then had no envelopes but folded letters, and you had to seal them, whether with wax or with these labels. And now you've got more envelopes coming out and being mass produced, and they're going from ungummed to gum. And so this was a transition. In the use of these. And why was that? So let's go back to the early 1850s and talk for a few minutes about the Great Exposition of 1851. That Great Exhibition, which was also known as the Great Exhibition of the Works of Industry of All Nations, or of the Crystal Palace Exhibition. And I think you know why, if you know your history here, there's the Great Crystal Palace Exhibition, was a large international exhibition which happened in Hyde Park in London for a number of months in 1851, from May 1st to October 15th. It was a significant moment in exhibitions and period of time back then. It was the first in a series of world's fairs and exhibitions. These became very popular throughout the 19th century and beyond. Cole and Prince Albert, the husband of the reigning monarch at the time, you know, Queen Victoria, helped to organize this mega event. This was not a small little, let's go out in the field and go visit. 6 million people, which is about a third of the entire population of Britain at the time, visited the Great Exhibition. This really was something to behold. And as the title up above tells you, great works of industry in all the nations, people from around the world gathered and got together to see the latest and greatest of what was going on across the world. One of those things was what we're going to talk about, which is relevant to what we're doing, which is really leaning in with the invention of an envelope making machine that could simultaneously fold and gum. And we're all, I think, aware of the Delarue family and the Delarue name and Edwin Hill as well. And Warren Delarue demonstrated at the 1851 Great Exposition in London their patented machine, and I've pulled an image here that was displayed in the Thomas Delarue and Company's booth, where Warren and his colleagues demonstrated the practical ability to create envelopes, punch them, cut them, fold them, and gum them, and here you go. They even put their little seal on it. There's a picture, I believe, from the obituary of Delarue there, of showing Warren. He's very impactful and has a long history, and I don't have time to go into all of the things he was involved with, but for the sake of this talk, the creation of what would eventually be, you know, mass production of envelopes that were gummed really would change the way individuals would, you know, write and then seal their letters and put them in the mail stream. And so on the next slide is really, again, an item I'm happy to share with you, which is an actual envelope from that event, from the Great Exhibition of 51, that was, as you can see, pre-printed, because this was done at the time, machine folded and gummed by Thomas Delarue and Co. at the Great Exhibition, 1851. They put the initials on the back flap there. They've got their letterpress printed in pale blue. More importantly, and this is contemporary, you've got two individuals that were there that wrote in pencil notations. The one above, I saw this made, RM. You have a second person attesting, so did I. Looks like an XH. So this is survived from that 1851 Great Exhibition where Delarue, I think, wowed a lot of folks there that he can mass produce, you know, envelopes of this type and style that were gummed, that were ready to get in the mail. So really nice piece of history that has survived. There are others out there. You can find them. This one just happens to have a little autograph of whomever these two individuals were that were fortunate to see that happen. And so with the creation, as we conclude this presentation, we've gone from wax to seals to gummed flaps over about a 20-year period of what I've covered here. And what I've tried to illustrate is an assortment of seals from my collection, which the number is probably closer to 150, but I'll say 125, that were utilized in the U.S. from the 1840s through the 1860s. These seals are in perforate. They have to be cut apart like postage stamps to be used. I showed you those intact panes and they weren't rouletted. You had to cut them out and use them. They're not common. Multiples are markedly uncommon. I showed you almost near complete sheetlets. There are very few of these that are still in existence. I'm very pleased to be able to preserve these, you know, and archive these. They are absolutely more valuable on cover, properly used, than off. You can tell when one has been used on cover by examining it closely and knowing if it was not added more in more modern times. Just by a little bit of analysis, you're able to see that that originated on that cover. The invention of the gummed envelope by Delarue and its broad availability in the early 1850s kind of eliminated the need for these seals. But as I showed you, even up until the mid 1860s, they were used less for sealing the folded letter or the ungummed envelope. And they were really used more as an affection to send whatever you were thinking or feeling to the individual you were writing to. Some were used on the outside, some were used on the inside. And so I thought it appropriate here to show a wax seal that was used on an envelope with a horse. I've got probably, add to the 125 of the labels I have, probably got another 50 or 75 of a broad array of wax seals, some very ornate, some with initials, some very simple. Some wax seals are actually using the circular date stamp because a postal clerk sealed the envelope and took the same canceling device and used it in the wax. And then they also canceled the front of the cover. Same exact. So there's some really interesting studies of wax. I thought appropriate, the farewell seal, because we're saying farewell to these seals with the advent of gummed envelope and stationery. And so that is my story. I appreciate you listening, and I'm more than happy to stop sharing and take some questions. And I'll stop now. Thank you. Thank you,
everybody. Awesome.
So that was my little trip down wax seals and envelope lane. And I'm more than happy to take any questions or comments from those that might know a little bit more about the subject than I do.
Charlie, I was talking to a postal clerk and I was saying in England, when you have a wax seal on it, which they still do, they charge extra. He said, we do here too. So if you ever use a wax seal on the back, It's an extra 20 cents.
It is extra. That is true.
Actually taken out of the system and because all that stuff gets gummed up in the machinery and
That's correct. Anything that is a little bit off of the body of that envelope has to be manually sorted, cannot go through the automation, and they upcharge that to 20 cents. That is correct.
I like that you started with seals and end with the envelopes. You know, I like the before and after. So thank you.
No, thank you, Paul. I appreciate that.
Charlie, I noticed on quite a bit of the British Registry envelopes, I see wax seals all the time. At least I have several that are on the back.
Yes.
Is that something they were doing much later? Or?
Yeah, so you can still find wax. Yeah, the wax seals used here on the back to seal a flap of a registered letter or a money letter or something that was very, that was at a different level of needing to protect it, used wax seals even into the early 1900s, Jim. You could find that being used with wax, absolutely. I've got money letters and other sort of registered letters. But that then phased away, I think, by the 1920s, because then you'll see them just using the physical hand stamp and or a certain tape to seal the back flap that the contents were valuable and that the clerk hand stamped it, registered it, docketed it, and then put it in the mail stream. But I have examples of wax into the 19-teens and 20s used still on U.S. envelopes. Yep. I do.
My friend's mom sent packages back to England that I remember when I first saw it using sealing wax to seal the string around the paper around the box.
Yep. Absolutely. Yeah. So you will find string.
Yeah.
You will find string. You'll find little ribbons. You'll find little notes attached. So they would embed and seal a myriad of objects into these. And again, they survived. I mean, you could see how very careful, too, on some of them that I've shown you and some I haven't, where they wanted to keep the wax seal intact. So they would cut the paper around the seal and they kept it intact, the wafer as well as the wax. So, and these were put away. So any other questions, thoughts, comments?
I'm curious, do you know anything about value with those on envelopes? I mean, I never see anything.
So I can tell you, you take a few things into account when you want to value some of these. You can acquire some depending on the condition and if there's contents and where it was going and if it's stamped or not stamped. And I've seen some of these sell for anywhere from $50 to $150+ for their use. I've seen some sell for a bit less, Jim. It really goes down to content and contents and the type of label. You could see I showed you green cancels and various rate markings, which I think all adds to the value. But, on the market today, I think the value sort of has been holding pretty steady with these from the postal history perspective and the notion label. They're not everywhere. They just aren't. I've been collecting these for, like I said, a few decades, and it's taken quite a while to amass this collection of about 125, 135. And that's kind of the range, Jim, that you'll see where these are. The envelope itself with the actual intact wafer seals, I can give you an estimate of what I've been offered for that. So that's a different, there's a few more zeros on that, Jim.
Yeah,
I'll tell you. There are very few that have survived that are intact that have the contents of the complete wafers intact. There's just not a lot of those out there. And if they are, they're in a museum. I know we had some down at the National Postal Museum that are still locked away in the safe. So very few.
Well, I'll send you my collection probably next year.
Thank you, sir.
Not as big as yours, but it's big.
I would love to see them. And if you have some of these seals, I have a census. I've been keeping a census of all of these labels, the types, the size, the dimension, the saying, and if I could attribute them to one particular, manufacturer or not. So, yeah, thank you. I'd love to see any of these that anybody has. Thanks.
Yeah, okay.
Thank you. Anything else before we pass it on? You're done, I'm sure, listening to me tell you about wafer seals. Yeah, go ahead, Tom.
That one for Chester County.
Yes, sir.
Could you send me a blow up of that? I think I know the town, but I'm not sure. I want to make a good look at it.
Yes, I absolutely will. Tom, last night before this talk, I spent 45 minutes again trying to decode that town. So if you could identify it, that would be great. Thank you.
Well, I know Chester County. It looked like fishing, but yet it didn't look like an F in the beginning.
You're right. It did not. But then again, you know, we know that some letters could get permutated quite a bit when the person's writing that out. So I will definitely send you that. Thank you. Any other questions say thank you? Go ahead, Paul.
Yep. Other questions? Well, sir, thank you.
Said it could be a name of an estate. That was very common in England, just to write the property name.
Correct. Yeah, you're right. And I have other correspondence from that era going to in Pennsylvania, in Virginia, and even in New York that absolutely went to the estate name. Because once you found out where it was and you knew the family, very quickly when you're searching, you saw that that was their estate and that was where it went. So it's possible, Mike, it went there. But Tom's got the eagle eye and he may decode it for us. So that'd be nice.
No pressure, Tom.
Yeah, no pressure.
And I know all the towns in this dang state anyway from doing what I did.
Yes, right. Hey, listen, let me just thank everybody again for your attention and for joining me here for this little presentation.